have great presenters. We have the chief, we have George. There's George. And I'm going to hand this over to Brad. So again, thank you all for being here.
Thank you, Donna. Well, good evening, everyone, and thank you so much for coming out. My name is Bradley Smith. I am the archivist most of the time, and sometimes assistant director at the Berks History Center. And we are so excited to be here with you tonight, and with our friends at the Reading Area Firefighters Museum, with whom we're partnering. This is a great topic, but I have a confession to make. I was born in 1973. So I missed Agnes by 16 months. But growing up, every time it rained, my mom would be like, oh, it's like Agnes. Every time there was a little flood in the little trickle across the street, oh, it's Agnes. I heard about Agnes every week. My grandparents, that was all they talked about. Agnes, Agnes, Agnes. So by the time I was 5 years old, I was reared to fear Agnes. But joking aside, it was a catastrophic event for our area. For the whole East Coast, in Pennsylvania alone, 50 people lost their lives. It was just a devastating, devastating event. One of the worst water disasters in Pennsylvania history. And it really, not only was it a tremendous disaster, but it really changed the sort of the cultural landscape of our community. It changed entire neighborhoods, the demographics of neighborhoods, because neighborhoods were gone. People had to move. It just changed communities. The Class I railroads, who were already really struggling by that point, many of them facing bankruptcy, for them that was kind of the death knell, the final nail in the coffin for them. So it really just 4 years later, we saw the disappearance of the Reading Company, the Lehigh Valley Railroad, Penn Central Corporation, Erie Lackawanna, and the emergence of Conrail, who many railroad historians kind of dread as the bad guy who took over all the great Class I railroads. So there's just so many layers to the story of Hurricane Agnes, so many things we could talk about. But we are very, very excited to have two fantastic speakers with us tonight. Two gentlemen that I know well, I consider them friends and mentors, Chief Bill Rehr, who, Bill, am I remembering correctly, you're with the fire department for 51 years?
Until I retired, it was 51 years, yes.
51 years, starting as a teenager, as a volunteer, and advancing to chief. And then, in retirement, Bill became the president of the Reading Area Firefighters Museum. And now you've been doing that for over a decade, I believe. Mm-hmm. So we also have George Meiser IX. Well known as an educator for over three decades in Berks County, the author of many, many passing scene articles in the Reading Eagle, many volumes with his wife Gloria Jean of the Passing Scene series, frequent speaker, winner of many community awards, and it's a real pleasure to have both George and Bill with us tonight. So without further ado, I'm going to pass the microphone over to Bill. But before I do, just two quick housekeeping notes. One is that the official word we've been told is that at 10 o'clock the lights go out. So we're gonna monitor that, see if there's any flexibility, any wiggle room with that. But that's kind of something we're keeping in the back of our minds. Also, we have plenty of water. If you would like a water before I hand the microphone over, or as I'm handing the microphone over, if you show me a hand real quick, I'll make sure you get a water. And finally, I've asked the IT folks if they could increase the air conditioning a little bit, because the temperature definitely went up when we went from three people to 90. So we thank you again for coming. Any hands for water? Okay, leave those hands up, please, for a minute, and I will turn it over to Bill.
Thanks, Bill. Thank you, Brad. I think most of us here tonight are among a very unique group of people who have lived through three 100-year events, except Brad. The first, of course, was the flood of Agnes, 1972. The second was the 100-year blizzard in January of 1996. And now we're living through the 100-year pandemic with COVID, 100 years after the Spanish flu epidemic of 1918-1919. And while I was putting the program together, I figured out we actually have a fourth one. Because one of the pictures you'll see in here of a flooded area shows a gas station selling Gulf gasoline for 34.9 cents a gallon. And I firmly believe that'll be a 100-year event. I'd like to see it again, but I don't think it will. Our program tonight consists of four parts. First, I'm going to give a quick overview of the Schuylkill River and why this particular area, part of Reading, floods compared to some other areas. Why the Schuylkill really floods at all. Secondly, George Meiser IX is going to review some of the historic freshets, as they used to call the floods. And I hope George will tell us why they called it a freshet.
I will.
I will then sort of chronicle the events of June 22nd and June 23rd from my perspective as a fireman who participated in a number of events and a number of situations that the average person doesn't get exposed to. And finally, we'll open it up for anybody from the floor who would like to get up and share their experiences in Agnes. I know I have one person here tonight who lived in the flooded area and lost possessions, home was completely flooded, and I think he'll share that story with you. Also want to acknowledge tonight where the source of our images came from that you'll see on the screen. The photos used in my presentation are from the files of the Berks History Center, the former Reading Eagle, and the Reading Firefighters Museum. When the Reading Eagle was sold some years ago, they gave some of their photos and negatives to the Berks History Center. Photos of Agnes that are used tonight were taken by former Eagle photographers Jay Sheridan Evans and Jim Cutler Jr. Some of these images were used in two publications by the former Reading Eagle entitled The River Rages and Storms of Berks County. The photos used in George Meiser's historical freshets presentation are from the Berks History Center archives, and the center's Holman Collection, Clock Collection, Koff Collection, Schneider Collection. Some of these images appeared in a book by Benjamin L. Bernhardt entitled Hurricane Agnes. None of the images being shown here tonight have been duplicated for sale or distribution, and no one has been charged admission or any fees to see these photos. Brad already told you that we found out the other night that all of RAC's buildings are programmed to shut down at 10 o'clock. So I don't know if there's any wiggle room or not. We'll find out if the lights go out. I'd like to start with a description of the Schuylkill River and some of the things that contributed to the unusual flooding during Agnes. Now, most of you probably know the Schuylkill River starts in all places Schuylkill County. But did you know it starts at three different places, all of which eventually merge to form the Schuylkill River that goes past here? So if you're looking up at the board, at the display, the west branch of the Schuylkill River starts near Minersville, and it flows south and joins the east branch at Schuylkill Haven. The Little Schuylkill starts in northeastern Schuylkill County, up around McAdoo, flows 30 miles and meets the west and east branch in Port Clinton. And from there, it becomes the Schuylkill River that flows by here. Now, on its way to Reading, there's a number of tributaries that contribute water to the Schuylkill, which during flooding causes a considerable increase in the amount of water that passes here. One of the major ones is the Maiden Creek. Now, we all know the Maiden Creek is the source of Reading's water. The Maiden Creek was dammed to create Lake Onalani. And of course, the pumping station at Lake Onalani is what sends our drinking water here. About a mile upstream is a place called Confluence Point in the Glenside section of Reading. It's where the waters of the Tulpehocken Creek join the Schuylkill. The Tulpehocken is a significant creek that provides a lot of water added to the Schuylkill River's volume. In fact, during Agnes, it's believed that the Tulpehocken entered the Schuylkill 16 feet above its normal water level. The immediate effect of that was flooding from that point on down. Now, if you want to see Confluence Point, if you drive up the West Shore Bypass, when you get to the exit mark North Wyomissing Boulevard, if you look over to your right, if you're heading north, you'll see the Schuylkill River almost right at the bypass, but off to the left is where the Tulpehocken Creek is entering the Schuylkill River. That was one of the first areas that flooded and closed the bypass during Agnes. As it continues down, about a couple blocks down the river, the Wyomissing Creek flows into the Schuylkill. If you ever try to get through West Reading at the Public Museum when there's flooding, you won't get there because that Wyomissing Creek has flooded at the museum and shut off Museum Road. Now, in addition to that, the Reading storm sewer system dumps a lot of water into the Schuylkill River from Riverside area all the way down to the very south end of the city. There's numerous discharges that you'll see if you go along the river that empty all the storm water into the Schuylkill. But there's two particular storm systems that are very noteworthy. One is the Bernhardt Creek. Bernhardt Creek comes from the Bernhardt Dam, supplies the Bernhardt Dam, and then flows down Spring Valley Road in Muhlenberg Township to the Kutztown Road. It flows down the Kutztown Road till it gets to the intersection with Delta Avenue. Delta Avenue is a street in the northernmost residential neighborhood of Reading called Northmont. It goes underneath Kutztown Road at Delta and then goes into a huge culvert underground, and from there it flows all the way down underneath Northmont, underneath Heaster's Lane, underneath Fifth Street, Center Avenue, underneath Glidden's, underneath the stadium parking lot, and finally dumps into the Schuylkill River at Carpenter Steel. Keep that one in mind, because in the early stages of Agnes, that was a big cause of early flooding in an area of Reading that normally doesn't flood. The second notable storm sewer system is the Rose Valley Creek. That flows down from Antietam into Eggleman's, Mineral Spring Park, and finally Pandora Park. And in the very southwestern corner of Pandora Park at 18th and Forest Street, it goes underground. Flows underneath Perkiomen Avenue, 18th Street, down to 16th, to Muhlenberg, underneath Muhlenberg Street, and eventually discharges in the river at the foot of South 6th Street near Canal Street. Now, less understood, that had an impact on Agnes, was Reading's sanitary sewer system.
Now, that's the system that takes care of all the wastewater from your homes. When you flush the toilet, you take a shower, you do the wash. Normally, that's a closed system underground and shouldn't be affected by rainwater. But we found out 2 years after Agnes, when the city hired an engineering company, that there was a significant amount of rainwater infiltration into the storms, into the sanitary sewer system. So it probably overwhelmed the capacity of the sewer plant. Now that sanitary sewer water flows down to one point, the pumping station down here at 6th and Canal Street. From there, it's pumped underneath the river to the sewage treatment plant over on Fritz's Island off of Morgantown Road. There's a contingency there that if the pumps fail for any reason, the city can dump raw sewage directly into the Schuylkill River. It's a violation of EPA regulations, Environmental Protection Agency, and the city gets fined every time they do that. But it's better than letting the sewage back up into people's homes. The problem with Agnes, however, overwhelmed the pumping plant because the pumps failed. But at one point, the pit where the sewage goes and then gets dumped into the river was under 20 feet of water. It couldn't dump. So people whose houses weren't being flooded by the Schuylkill were now getting sewage backing up in their homes. So that, I think you'll see that's why Agnes ended up being the perfect storm. So with that kind of a background, George Meiser is going to talk about some of the previous freshets that hit the Reading area. And you'll see some really nice photographs from the 1800s, actually. So, George.
While I'm looking at this, something came to mind as Bill was talking. During Agnes, Rich Foley and I talked about the Union Canal. The Union Canal paralleled the Tuppahoppin Creek. And during Agnes, there was so much water in the Union Canal, you actually could have floated a canoe from Wilmersdorf down to Burnville. I wasn't brave enough to do it, but the thought crossed my mind.
In researching the history, we're on. In researching the history of the flooding hereabouts, it came as a surprise to learn that these devils of nature were not referred to as floods. The index to Morton L. Montgomery's 1886 History of Berks County makes no reference whatever to floods. His index references these watery disasters as freshets, which most of which were, in point of fact, what we would call today flash floods, as the waters rose so disastrously fast that those in the paths often were caught unaware of the great dangers inherent and were swiftly carried away to a watery grave. The earliest flood or freshet of which we have extensive information is the one which occurred on September the 2nd, 1850, when the water crested at Reading at the Penn Street Bridge at 26.2 feet. Ordinarily, low water beneath the Penn Street Bridge during that time period was between 5 and 6 feet. I've often wondered before they built the Penn Street Bridge, which opened completely in 1818, how did they cross the river? How did they ford the river? Old maps refer to as the Reading Ford. They must have had high wagons or something. I've often wondered about that. Anyway, coverage of this event was reported in area papers in great detail, as photography had not yet existed hereabouts. True, the process was invented in 1839, but was not immediately developed into a practical form. Charles L. Philippi is generally credited for introducing photography to locals as a resident photographer in the mid-1840s. That said, his photos were all taken indoors with greatly controlled lighting procedures with no movement of any kind for 40 or more seconds. They hated when a woman came in to have her photograph taken and she had palsy. No way could Mr. Phillips have taken views of rushing waters and things of the sort. To convey what occurred, newspapers reported flooding particulars in great detail so that readers might experience what occurred in their mind's eyes. All local papers of the time reported extensively on the 1850 freshet. What follows is a representative example. The papers of the time, the Reading Gazette and Democrat, for one, had a whole issue, and things were reported in great detail, sometimes too much detail. Incidentally, it was at this time that the covered bridges of Berks all washed away, beginning with the one at Hamburg. It was like the domino effect. Hamburg came loose, Shoemakersville, all the way down the line, throughout all Berks County, all the bridges were destroyed. I have some information here on that I took from the Berks Reading Gazette and Democrat for September the 7th, 1850. The river at Reading commenced rising on Monday morning at about 3 o'clock and continued to rise with such fearful rapidity that the whole lower part of the city was completely inundated by a swift and almost irresistible torrent of water, which carried nearly everything with it in its fearful course. So entirely unexpected was the advance of the freshet, and so great was the body of water which came rushing down upon us, that the inhabitants were taken completely by surprise. There's your flash flood. Totally, the river rose rapidly all day long, and about 3 o'clock p.m., it was 23 feet above the low water mark at the foot of Penn Street. During the whole of Monday, a large number of boats, portions of bridges, dwelling houses, stables, trees, haystacks, and the wrecks of property of every description floated down in the rapid current, sweeping away everything before them with fearful destructiveness. Between 9 and 10 o'clock in the morning, a portion of the Penn Street Bridge, which by the way opened, you could use part of it in 1812, but it was 1818 before it was fully opened, reaching from the abutment on the side of the first pier, the Reading side, was carried off by a heavy boat which damaged and dashed against it, the water being within a few inches of the floor. An hour afterwards, another portion of the bridge gave way, and at about 12 o'clock, the remaining portion, which still adhered to the abutment on the opposite bank, was also swept away, leaving scarcely a vestige of this elegant and substantial structure. The original Penn Street Bridge was very ornate with statuary and all that sort of thing. Between 12 and 1 o'clock, Kissinger's Bridge, which stood a mile, I love that, which stood a mile above the city. I wondered about that. Kissinger's Bridge crossed the Schuylkill at the foot of Spring Street, below the present Glen's Penn Street, I'll try it again, George, Schuylkill Avenue Bridge, and crossed over the Schuylkill to Toby's showboat, if any of you remember the showboat. As a matter of fact, until more recent years, if you came down Spring Street, there was an old German club, which I think is an abandoned building today. If you, there was a road that crossed over the tracks, and if you would stand in certain times of the year, particularly in the winter, you could see the old road on the Glenside side going up, making a turn, and joining the road to Burnville. Between 12 and 1 o'clock, Kissinger's Bridge, which stood a mile above the city, came floating down the river and was followed shortly thereafter by Lice's Bridge and the County Bridge at Hamburg. A portion of the Penn Street Bridge lodged for a moment on the city island. Anyone know what the city island was?
Independence.
Very good. Independence Island. I often wonder what happened to Independence Island, and the answer was, well, part of it's still there. When they widened the old river road for the bypass that we know today, the land between Independence Island and the old river road, they filled in. So that as you drive along, if you know where to look, you can still see part of what had been Independence Island at one time. Anyhow, was immediately carried downward and dashed broadside against the Lancaster Bridge, sweeping a large portion of it from its abutments. And together, the ponderous wrecks pursued their course down the stream. Can you imagine those bridges floating down the river? I mean, those were massive structures. We're not talking about a little bridge. We're talking about massive structures. The remainder of the Lancaster Bridge was carried away shortly afterwards. While this work of destruction was going on, the scene presented along the river was truly awful and heart-sickening. Dwelling houses, stables, and shops were overturned, trees uprooted, fences torn away, and in the midst of the general wreck, persons were hurrying to and from wherever they were going in boats. I can't imagine having a boat in the Schuylkill with all that activity going on in the water. At the imminent risk of their lives, humanly engaged in rescuing those whose dwellings had been surrounded by water before they had a time to escape. Many thrilling scenes of peril were witnessed by the crowd which thronged the streets touching upon the flood, and many acts of heroism were performed which are worthy of lasting gratitude and honor. Final comment. One boat was manned by Mr. William Seitzinger and William Moyer, who contended heavily with the destructive element and succeeded in bringing safety to many persons, men, women, and children, who would otherwise have found a watery grave. In one of their precious, perilous trips, they passed the house of Mr. Michael Sands in Front Street between Franklin and Chestnut, containing Mr. Sands, his wife, and four children. The house was beginning to totter, and as they passed it, put their boat already full, and they could not take anyone but the infant child with them. This was scarcely done before the house fell with great crash, precipitating the three remaining children into the water, and it was supposed they immediately drowned. You have to forgive me, I'm looking at 8-point type. Mr. Sands was carried some distance down the stream, where he grasped a tree and held fast until the boat came to his rescue. His wife floated away on a bed, was carried over the big dam, and there, sad to relate, she was drowned in spite of repeated efforts made to save her. Her dead body was found Tuesday evening, deeply embedded in mud and rubbish in Mr. Goodhart's cornfield, 6 miles below Reading. The bodies of three children have not been recovered at the time of this report. The freshet of 1869, we're moving up a bit. By the way, by the time of 1869, we still had no photographs, but they were including engravings. Both the Eagle and the Times had staff artists who would go out and sketch scenes, and they were rather good at what they did. And they were brought back. I don't know how they did this overnight. How they would engrave a plate for publication for the next day. They must have worked all through the night with however they did it. But the Reading Eagle didn't have regular photographs. Anyone want to guess when the Eagle put on its first half-toned picture? 1908 was the first photograph actually reproduced in the Reading Eagle. The freshet of 1869, when the water crested at Reading at 24.5 feet, was well and extensively reported in all the local papers. Moreover, for the first time, there were photographs that showed levels of destruction in detail. You went, oh, very good, very good. Well, that's just great. Okay, in detail. Reading's renowned photographer, Fred Yeager, 433 Penn Street, whose historic home and studio is currently in some peril, was on hand to take many memorable shots of local flood scenes. There are about 11 Fred Yeager views of the flood of 1869. The archives of the Berks History Center contain most of Yeager's freshet views. The best of these appear in various volumes of the Passing Scene series. One of the most interesting of Yeager's views, taken in 1869, shows the Lancaster Bridge. Let me backtrack on that one. Shows the Lancaster Bridge, aka Bingaman Street Bridge. By the way, interesting thing about Bingaman Street. Bingaman Street had a very interesting history. We all know Bingaman Street generally, and it sort of stops. It goes up, crosses over Perkiomen Avenue, and continues up to Hessian Camp. Bingaman Street went to Hessian Camp. So Bingaman Street turned into what street?
Middle Spring Road.
Hill Road. went into Hill Road, up the line. Anyhow, it was built as a three-span structure minus the span closest to the Reading side. There we are, it was a three-span bridge. Can you imagine the weight of that thing? I mean, just look at that. It was washed away and started floating down the Schuylkill. Someone at the telegraph office at Reading contacted an operator at Douglasville that a bridge is heading your way. How it was accomplished defies belief, but somehow the bridge span was removed from the river and set up at Douglasville, near what most will know as Morlotton, over the Mounts Jones house is, in that section of Douglasville. How do you get a bridge, a span of that size, out of the raging Schuylkill? I can't imagine how they did that. I can't imagine with modern tools, but with modern equipment, how you get something that heavy out of the river with the speed that the river was flowing. Anyhow, accordingly, Douglasville had one of the most impressive of the rural bridges in Berks, as it was a two-lane span, the only one of its kind outside of Reading. Motorists might have asked, why would they build a two-lane bridge at Douglasville? The answer was, they didn't build it there, they fished it out of the river. The flood of 1902, at which time the river crested in Reading at 25.5 feet, was well reported in the newspapers and photographed extensively. By this time, many of the affected towns had a local photographer who documented the extent of the damage. Moreover, by 1902, there were a few folks in every town who had a Kodak and took pictures to document the event. A number of these can be found in the files of the Historical Society. The flood of 1942, at which time the river crested at 22.5 feet, did a great deal of damage to the Schuylkill Canal system in our area. As might be assumed, businesses and homes along the river were heavily damaged, some washed away. This was the first of the river's floods of which I have something of a recollection, a little memory from time from way, way back. When I was a little kid, I lived in the very last house on West Douglas Street, 506 West Douglas. And just a short walk down from my house, down West Douglas Street, it took you down to the river. You would walk down there, there was a railroad track, and by the railroad track, there used to be a big log. Mother and I would sit in that log and we'd watch the trains go slowly by. And then you'd walk over the railroad tracks and you'd turn right, and there was Kissinger's Lock House. Now, living in the Lock House at that time was the Airgood family who squatted there. And Mary Jane Airgood was a little girl with whom I played way back at that time. The flood of 1942 came by, and I was sitting on the front porch of our house at 506 West Douglas Street, and I saw Mary Jane Airgood and her parents, with only the clothing on their backs, coming up West Douglas Street, crossing past Bear Park, and they disappeared from my sight. Many years later, I started writing for the Reading Eagle in 1977. Many years later, I did a story and I mentioned about Kissinger's Lock, and I mentioned about the Airgood family being the last family to reside there. My telephone rang. I said, hello. She said, you'll never guess who this is. I said, well, who is it? She said, I am Mary Jane Airgood. We haven't seen each other for a long time. You can say that again. We had planned to get together. Unfortunately, she had rapidly progressing ovarian cancer, and she died before we ever got together. So I never saw her again after 1942. Reports of local floods sometimes overlook the one of 2006, which was the second worst in local history. I had forgotten that. You know, you keep hearing about the flood of 1850, the flood of 1869. Agnes, you forget that we had a nasty flood, the worst, second worst in local history. Water crested at Reading at 26.3 feet. My keenest recollection of this event was what I had seen at the northwest corner of 422 Philadelphia Pike and Shelbourne Road in Exeter Township, opposite the entrance to Shelbourne Square Shopping Center. The section of the Reading Country Club greens, most visible from Shelbourne Road where Dunkin' Donuts is, looked like Lake Onalani. We could not believe that. You looked over and you thought you were looking at Lake Onalani. All you saw was this mass of water. And I took a picture of it with my Kodak, with my Sony Mavica, which was famous for losing the pictures. Anyhow, all you could see was this large expanse of water. That's it. Oh, sorry about that. What do I do?
This is 1816.
Oh, 1816. Okay. Oh, okay. We have the Penn Street Bridge looking over from West Reading. There was part of of an old foundry, which used to be at one. There was a distillery on that property. You'll see it then. But this is the Penn Street Bridge, and over there is Dr. Benson's steam grist mill on the far right. Yeah, Dr. Benson's steam grist mill. And for a while they had a school in there, which always amazed me. That was a massive structure. I've often wondered, you know, the weight of those things, how they supported when some of the carriages and so forth went through there. There was a lot of weight put on those bridges. You know, Reading had what they called three Reading bridges. Did you know that? Three Reading bridges owned by the city. Penn Street, Lancaster Avenue, and the third is? Poplar Neck was a Reading Bridge. You know where the Animal Rescue League is? Okay, you cross over that bridge into whatever's over there these days. There was a covered bridge there, a rather big one. Yeah, the Poplar Neck covered bridge. Okay, the next one. There's the Penn Street Bridge looking from West Reading. Over here was a quarry that operated for many, many years using the stone from Lion Box Hill. Remember Lion Box Hill? But when they first mentioned about putting a clover leaf at this end of the Penn Street Bridge, and they're going to remove part of Lion Box Hill, my father said, well, that's preposterous. They'll never get rid of that. Well, they did. I remember at supper time one night, it was about 4:05, and I don't know how much dynamite they used, but it put a crack right across our ceiling, and we were at 506 West Douglas Street, pretty far away from Lion Box Hill. So we remember that very clearly. And over there was a foundry, a rolling mill, and earlier there was a brewery right on that side where you see that large smokestack. And of course we recognize the churches in the background. This quarry operated for many, many years. As a matter of fact, I interviewed Otto Heck a long time ago, and he said, you know, that rock formation was rather extensive. When you come down from West Reading, the hill heading towards the Penn Street Viaduct, on the right-hand side was, what's the name of that? Was it the Candle Inn or the Candle?
Yeah.
What is it? Okay, there was a big mansion up on top of that hill years back. The state police had been in there a long time ago. Anyhow, when you came down the hill, that rock formation came halfway out into Penn Avenue. So coming down the hill, you had to go around that. And Otto Heck said his dad almost ran into it one time with a wagon and could have destroyed the wagon. So when you came down that hill, you had to go around that rock formation. You go by there today, there's a big stone retaining wall. Well, that retaining wall retains. Next. Oh, there we are. That was the foundry, the Berglitz Foundry. That was 1869, the flood of 1869. That would be at the foot of Front Street, at the foot of Court Street, excuse me. That would be its location. Later on, there was a paper mill there. At some point, that paper mill blew up. A little bit of a problem there, but that's a whole other story. Next picture. The flood of 1869, this was a canal boat that was floated down the river. I think the label is below Reading. 1869, a canal boat wrecked. Next. This one I had never seen before tonight. Obviously, some more damage from the flood of 1869. Next. That's it for me.
That's still history.
That's still history.
Yeah.
Well. This is also new.
Gas company, it says.
Yeah, the gas company.
Canal Street.
Yeah, Canal Street. How many of you remember the expanding gas tank? The foot was down South Fifth. It was funny. You'd be there around supper time, and the ladies were going to make supper, and they started turning on the gas, and the top of the tank used to go up and down. They'd turn the gas on, it would start to go down, and the gas company would manufacture gas, and it would go up again, and then more people would turn on the stove, and it would go down again. You could actually watch it go up. How many remember that? It used to go up. Am I the oldest one here? Some of you do remember that. Okay. The next one. Isn't this amazing? There are pictures of South 7th Street that appear from time to time. I don't know how many cross members they had on South 7th Street, but those lines were really very well loaded.
1933.
Is that the 33 flood?
Yeah.
Okay. Pennsylvania. Well, I don't know nothing about that. I wasn't around until 37, so.
Pennsylvania Railroad
yeah,
Station.
Yeah, Pennsylvania Railroad Station. Look at all the folks in the Penn Street Viaduct looking down. By the way, you look at old pictures of the Penn Street Viaduct, of the Penn Street Bridge, actually the Iron Truss Bridge, which was put up in 1884 to take the place of the old covered bridge. They decided they were going to build an iron truss bridge in place of the covered bridge, so they took it down in 1884, used that lumber to build houses in West Reading.
Kind of where we're sitting right now.
What's that?
That picture's right where we're at right now.
Yeah, that's true. That's true. Anyhow, when they put up the new Penn Street Viaduct, it's pictures of the old station. It was a very ornate Victorian building. And when they put up the current Penn Street Viaduct, it was much wider than the old Iron Truss Bridge, so they had to lop off the roof. Which is why, remember, crossing before they tore the building down, you'd look down on the station. Originally, you'd look up at the station. And it was because of the widening of the bridge area. Next. This one I never saw before, 1933 again.
River Road.
Yeah, River Road.
You see the Lebanon Valley Bridge in the background.
Can you? I don't see that.
Very far in the back, all the way on the side.
Okay.
Yeah.
Up there, there you go.
Yep. Okay.
And that Buttonwood Street Bridge right below it.
It was only a year old, Buttonwood Street.
Buttonwood Street. Anyone know the old name for Buttonwood Street? Second Hockley Lane. I bet you didn't know that. The second Hockley Lane. What was first Hockley Lane?
West Elm.
School. No, not school. I was guessing you're okay.
The old schoolhouse sat on the corner of
West Elm. West Elm?
West Elm. Next.
Canal Street.
There's your gas tank.
Is that Canal Street, George?
That's heading towards the Bingham Street Bridge. No, that's what? That's a foot of Fifth, is it?
No, this is a 400 block.
The 400 of what?
Of Canal.
Of Canal?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Okay, I'm with Canal. Look at the size of that tank. What happened to those tanks? Remember, there was a newer one that they put up, smaller one. I think we can blame Agnes, can't we?
Yeah, we could.
Yeah. Charlie, I didn't see you were here. Charlie Adams, editor of the Historical Review of Berks County, the finest magazine in the county, Charles Adams. Next.
Third and Bingham.
Yeah, Third and Bingham, right near the Bingham Street Bridge. Again, Bingham Street wound up as Hill Road and take you right up to Hessian Camp. I didn't believe that when I first heard it, but then you take a map, you take a ruler, and you put it down, and they're in a straight line, with the exception that they cut into it to put a couple houses there, so you would go up, over, up, and then back up to Hill Road. We're not sure about this, but I'll be Bill.
Well, it said 200 block of Court Street.
200 block of Court Street.
Looking east.
On the corner of Court and 2nd was Hope Rescue Mission at one time on the left-hand side. Because I used to go to Hope Rescue Mission with my nickels as a child to buy phonograph records, which drove my father crazy. They had a barn behind Hope Rescue. How many remember Hope Rescue Mission at 2nd? 2nd and Court. That was a great place to go. You have a dollar, you get to come home with a whole lot of neat stuff.
including a nice eardrum that I'm so pleased to have. I thought I'd put it away for my old age. I'm ready to reach for it now. Next. Did you see it was doing the orange car, Bill?
It's around that area, Front and River Road, and where Front and River Road come together.
Okay, where Front and River Road come together. Next. There is your there's your old Pensy station. And according to what someone told me a number of years ago, that does anyone know for sure, that building I think was an office building for the railroad company. That's what someone had said to me at one time.
This is from 42.
1942, that's my time. Okay, 1942. You look at that and you wonder, what do you do with all that water? When you think of that, that mass of water, wait for it to go down. Where does it all go? Next.
That's it.
Thank you, Bill.
Well, now we move to the modern time and Agnes. This is a very nice map that was that appeared in the book by Benjamin Bernhardt. And what it shows is the life history of Agnes from Flag Day, June 14, 1972, to when it ended up in southeastern New York on June the 22nd. Agnes was born in the Yucatan Peninsula on June 14th, moved out into the waters between the Yucatan and Cuba, and lollygagged around until it built up strength in the warm waters, and then moved northward at a fairly fast clip, gaining strength from a tropical depression to a tropical storm, finally came on land in the panhandle of Florida on June 19th is a Category 1 hurricane at 85 miles an hour. Now, as hurricanes go in Florida, Agnes wasn't a particularly bad hurricane, only 85 miles an hour, but it set a record for spawning the most number of tornadoes ever generated in Florida from a tropical system. 28 tornadoes hit Florida that day. The storm itself very quickly downgraded because of friction with land, which they tend to do, and moved as a tropical storm and depression up in through Georgia, South Carolina, moved off the coast of North Carolina on the 21st. Now, it's interesting, on the 21st, as it was moving up in this direction, Wally Canaan, the weatherman, said that for our area, we were going to have clearing skies. Well, we had 3 inches of rain, because what happened was, and what they didn't count on at first, was the fact that Agnes now became what meteorologists call an extratropical cyclone, which means instead of being a tropical storm, which depends on the warm waters for circulation, because the waters of the Atlantic in June are pretty cold, it turned into a very intense low pressure system that reacts with the other weather systems that are moving through the area, sort of like a nor'easter. And so as it went up, it encountered a blocking high pressure system that was sitting over this area. And so instead of going northeast like most storms do, up off of Long Island and then Nova Scotia and out in the North Atlantic, the storm, as they say, retrograded or backed into southeastern New York State. Now, Agnes was particularly noteworthy because it had one of the largest circulations of any tropical storm that started in June. The storm had a diameter of 1,000 miles. So as it parked in this area, this obviously had a profound effect on Pennsylvania, New Jersey, New York. And actually, Pennsylvania seemed to be the bullseye, because of the $3.1 billion damage that the storm did in 12 states, Pennsylvania was responsible for $2.1 billion. Also, I've seen different numbers about fatalities.
One source says 117 fatalities, and 48 of them were in Pennsylvania. So Pennsylvania was obviously the bullseye. Now, to set the stage for all of this, the spring of 72 had been unusually wet. The 3 months preceding Agnes, we had 15 inches of rain here. And of the first 20 days of June, 10 of those days, we had rain. And on June 21st, we had 3 inches of rain. So the stage was now set to provide an ample amount of rainfall and saturated soil. That brings us to the 22nd of June, the big day. Now I'm gonna kind of mix my own personal involvement here with what went on as we talk about how the storm developed. In June of 72, I was not yet a full-time employee of the fire department. I was a volunteer, which I had been for 13 years. My regular job was at the Carpenter Steel Research Laboratory on Center Avenue at Union Street. I went to work that morning not having heard the upgraded forecast that said severe flooding. And right after I got to work, around 8:30, it started to rain torrentially. And in the 3 hours between 8:30 and 11:30 a.m., we had 4 inches of rain on top of what had already fallen. Now, Carpenter, around 10 o'clock, made the unprecedented announcement that they were shutting the plant down at 12 noon. That was very unusual for Carpenter, unprecedented. But the forecast had said that there would be severe flooding, particularly north of Reading. And a lot of Carpenter employees commuted every day from areas north of Reading, particularly the coal regions, because Carpenter was one of the best paying employers in the city. Now, I wasn't worried about getting home because I lived right up the hill off of Center Avenue in the Center Park District. So I figured, well, at 12 o'clock, I'll go over to the Reading Fire Department's Riverside Fire Station, which at that time was at the northeast corner of Front and Exeter Streets, and find out if anything was going on, if the fire department had any special situations going on or mobilizations, because I usually spent my lunch hours there anyway with the paid drivers on duty. So as I got into the Riversides, I'd only been there a few minutes, and Engine 11 from the Riversides got dispatched to the 1900 block of North Front Street to check on people trapped in submerged cars on the municipal stadium parking lot. Now, we all kind of looked at each other in disbelief. How can anybody be trapped on that big parking lot at the municipal stadium where we park for ball games? Doesn't sound right. Well, I geared up, jumped on the truck, responded with them. It only took us about a minute to get there because the fire station is only 2 blocks away. And as we went out Front Street and passed Carpenter and started toward the railroad track that crosses right before you get down to the parking lot, we came to a screeching halt because this is what we found. We were all in shock. I mean, we had been only 2 blocks away and had no idea what was going on here. Fortunately, there was no one trapped in any cars. What people saw and thought were submerged cars were actually 55-gallon drums floating down from the Glidden Company a couple blocks away. Well, after we regained our composure and ascertained there was no real emergency, we started looking at this and thinking, why is everything going in this direction? The river is over here, and it flooded at 11:30 that morning. It reached flood stage, and this picture's taken around 12:30. Why is everything going this way? Well, remember the Bernhardt Creek description I gave you of everything that's supposed to flow under Glidden's, under the stadium? Well, everything was now flowing above ground. The reason being, the river was flooded, so the discharge outlet on Carpenter Steel property, where it dumps into the Schuylkill, couldn't dump. The river was getting higher than the outlet. And up where it goes underground at Kutztown Road and Delta Avenue, debris being washed down the Spring Valley Road was now blocking the intake. So instead, all the water was going down through Northmont, onto Heister's Lane, over to Fifth Street, Center Avenue, everything was shut down. This is the corner of Fifth and Richmond. Dunkin' Donuts on the right, the old post office annex on the left, wasn't going anywhere. This is Richmond Street, which is over here, becomes Heister's Lane as you go underneath the railroad culvert. So the water was coming through there, and if you go up here under this bridge, you come to Crescent Street, which is part of Northmont. So the two were flowing all this water that was coming from Bernhardt's area across here. At one point, the Reading Eagle said there was only two streets going out of Reading northbound. Hamden Boulevard, if you could get to it, and Schuylkill Avenue, 183 was still open. Now, other areas of the city were beginning to flood because of the Schuylkill. Here's a gas station at the corner of Lancaster Avenue and New Holland Road, A.W. Golden's, and there's the gasoline for sale. Good Gulf, I think, is the 89 octane, so above that, I think it's 33.9 was regular unleaded. 100-year event. Back to Riverside area, what had been flowing behind Glidden's had widened because of the continuous amount of water that was coming down, and now the front of Glidden's is flooded. This is Burn Street. Fifth Street's on your right, Center Avenue's up here. We're at about 3rd and Burn Streets. And these are employees of Glidden's being evacuated from Glidden's by boat. Of course, you know none of these buildings are here anymore, not because of Agnes, but at the time in 1972, this Glidden's facility was considered the largest paint manufacturing facility under one roof east of the Mississippi River. It looks here like it might have been in the middle of the Mississippi River. One thing that should be pointed out, and I'm surprised that we didn't have more problems with this is very dangerous in urban areas. Why? Because manhole covers pop off as things get flooded underground and above ground. Initially, when they pop, of course, you can see the guys are coming up out of the street. But once the level above the street and below the street are equalized, it's just a hole. And if you walk in it, you're going down. And nobody's going to find you. And I'm surprised. I saw a lot of boat rescues in Birdsboro, same thing. But fortunately, there were only two fatalities in Berks County, by the way, and that was a husband and wife in Perry Township whose car was washed off the road. About that time, I went home, checked on my house, and no, I wasn't having any problems. We were high and dry, so that was fortunate. I decided to give some time to the fire department because everybody at home was fine. And the fire chief, who was Russ Mogul at the time, was a very good friend of mine. He lived three blocks away. And I found out he had stopped home to get some lunch. So I gave him a call and I said, anything special going on, anything I can do? And he said, I'm going back out to look around, see what's going on in the city, see if, you know, how our access is to different parts of the city. He said, if you want to go along, I'll pick you up. Well, hey, no better way to see the city under these circumstances than to be with the top man in the department. And so I took his offer. Well, the first place we went was back out to Riverside, and by now the rain had slowed down considerably, so some of that area was starting to ease up, the runoff from Bernhardt's. From there, we went down to the corner of 2nd and Penn. Now, the Penn Street Bridge was being closed because 2nd and Penn was underwater. But this is the lot on the southwest corner of 2nd and Penn, where about 5 hours earlier, city officials participated in a groundbreaking ceremony for the new Holiday Inn. The only thing now is a sign that says there's going to be a Holiday Inn here someday. Now, this building here, it was actually Lynette Candy's warehouse. That building is still there. That's now Competition Tire from Penske. That's 2nd and Franklin. And of course, on the half street behind this, which was Grape Street, there was a men's clothing manufacturer named Herman Oritsky's. That building was there. And this was the Corbett building. Now, if you went up on the Penn Street Bridge and looked north, this is what you saw. Buttonwood Street Bridge is here. This is all the city's waterfront along River Road. Sunshine Brewery was still here, and Ace Carton was still here. Looking a little more north, this is the roof of the Pennsylvania Railroad Station, which used to be right at the Penn Street Bridge. Here's the orange car. Everybody remember the orange car? We used to be able to buy fresh fruit and stuff in the winter. That's the orange car. This is Front Street. This is Front and Washington Streets, the corner, which was Lynette Candy's. And Front Street came down this way, eventually passed here. Now, this picture was taken after the flood, but it shows you essentially what was there before the flood. This is where you're sitting right now. This is where the Oakham Library is. This is the street that runs in the front. And this area was all, this was all part of the Pennsylvania Railroad's freight station and freight yards. Everybody knows the Reading Company, of course, with the outer station and the big yards north of Penn and Franklin Street Station. At the turn of the century, the Pennsylvania Railroad had a pretty significant presence here. Their tracks ran right along the Schuylkill River, right through this area where we're sitting. And so, before the flood, this is what their yards looked like. This is what they looked like during the flood, and this is where you're sitting right now, right here. At the end of Front Street was a big warehouse called the Wirtz Warehouse, which was a storage building. And that was down here at the corner at Front and Franklin Street. Of course, that was taken down for the urban renewal of this area, and not necessarily because of Agnes. Another picture looking a little bit more southeast, same area. This is where you're sitting right here. And again, looking even more east, and you're sitting right here. You wouldn't have been sitting here in 72. Now, at one point, these following pictures were really taken the next day. The date on them said the 22nd, but I know it's not correct because you can see the river's receding from where it had been. But it still gives you a good idea of the flooding that did occur. Again, the Oakham Library would be right here. There's the Pennsylvania Railroad Station, the Penn Street Bridge, and the traffic can only go up Penn Street because South 2nd, North 2nd is still flooded. There's Competition Tire, which was Lynette Candy's. There's the Wirtz Warehouse. Bypass, if you notice, no traffic. The Cloverleaf is flooded. We're underneath the bridge from Penn Avenue, still flooded. The river crested at 4:30 a.m. on the 23rd, the day after the flooding. At one point, the Eagle said that the water was receding at the rate of a foot an hour. But even at that, since it had been 19 feet over flood stage, it's going to take the best part of the day for the water to recede. Again, the Penn Street Bridge. Yoakum would be right here. This is South Front Street, and this is North Front Street. And there's the orange car. This is a view looking over Franklin and Chestnut Streets. Franklin Street is here, Chestnut Street is here. Again, Lynette Candy's Competition Tire and Yoakum would be over about here. This is looking down Spruce Street below Front to the riverfront. Now, Riverfront Drive down here wasn't quite the same as the original street. The street that was along the river was called Water Street, and that ran right along here. There had been a six-story Penn Hardware warehouse here that burned down the year before. But you can see, the reason I say that these pictures were taken the next day, and I'm thinking around 9 or 10 o'clock in the morning, you can see from the staining on the streets where the water had been and where it is now. So it's receding. Looking over from West Reading, again, a lot of traffic trying to get back into Reading now the day after. Bypass is still shut down. Riverfront's still flooded. Yoakum would be here. The Bingaman Street Bridge, nobody on it, because the intersection back then was still the three-way intersection of 4th Street, Bingaman Street, and Laurel Street. Now it's 4th Street and Laurel Street. There's new housing development where Bingaman Street used to be. But this intersection's flooded, and bypass still flooded here. Looking down on the Bingaman Street Bridge, no traffic, no traffic on the bypass. This would have been Water Street, which came up to the end. There was a place called the Stanton Barrel Works here. This is South 3rd Street, coming down to Bingaman. If you ever heard of the Pacarac Hotel, that's right here. I know some of you have. Aerial view of the intersection of Lancaster Avenue and Morgantown Road, Queen City Diner. Again, see where the water had been? Now it's down to here, it's starting to recede. Underneath this bridge is the lowest point in that intersection. But you can see here it had been up on the bypass too. This is Schlegel Park and the Schlegel Park swimming pool. Okay. Here's an interesting shot. This is the foot of South 6th Street. This is Canal Street. Here is the city's sewage pumping station. There's a pit on the side where the sewage gets collected and then from there gets pumped over to Fritz's Island. As I said, the contingency is when the pumps shut down, and they did because everything shorted out, all the electrical equipment shorted out, the pit couldn't dump because it's still underwater. Now, fortunately, during the flood, there weren't any fires in Reading. However, Birdsboro wasn't so lucky. This is an aerial shot of Facera's furniture store and warehouse that burned to the ground, well, burned to the waterline, in Birdsboro. This whole area had been underwater, so obviously the fire department couldn't get to it. The only floods I know of in Reading where there were serious fires was 1902. The first fire was right down the street here, about a half a block at Front and Franklin. There was a place called the Fox Terracotta Company, and it burned to the ground because the fire department couldn't get to it. Later on in the day, a barn at 6th and Willow at the Grings Coal Yard burned to the ground, or burned to the water line, same reason. It's not lost on me that
Sarah's address in Birdsboro was 123 Cinder Street. There was one humorous incident on the 22nd when I was riding with Chief Mogul. One of the other chiefs, Al Battistini, he was also on duty. And he was out in the north end of town, and the fire dispatcher called him and said, "We just got a report that the Buttonwood Street Bridge collapsed." And we all froze, because Buttonwood Street and Schuylkill Avenue were the only two bridges that had traffic on them at the height of the storm. And if the Buttonwood Street Bridge had collapsed, we would have had a catastrophic mass casualty incident on our hands. So everybody's just barely breathing, waiting for Al to answer. And you had to know Al Battistini and appreciate the way he could say things. But he said, "Gee, I hope not. I'm standing on it." What had happened was, on the Pennsylvania Railroad tracks that ran north of the Buttonwood Street Bridge, there was a freight car that got lifted up by the floodwaters and floated down the river. And it crashed into one of the bridge abutments. It made a heck of a noise, of course. People who lived on West Buttonwood Street and the area around there just assumed that the Buttonwood Street Bridge collapsed. Thank goodness it didn't, and it's still there. Now, while I was riding with Russ around 9 p.m., he got a call asking for the city's longest ladder truck to be dispatched to the Dauberville Bridge because two National Guardsmen who were attempting to evacuate a family from a farm on the other side of the bridge got washed off the road. They were in a military deuce and a half, which is a 2.5-ton truck that normally does very well in high water, but not necessarily bad current. At any rate, their truck got washed off the road. They managed to cling to some trees that had been along the riverbank, but were now part of the river. And they needed to be rescued, and nobody could get to them. The idea might have been a good idea, but it didn't end up being a good idea. What they wanted was, this is the city's ladder company number 2. Now, this is an older picture, so the tractor that was on here was not the same one. The tractor that was on there was a newer tractor from 1966. But this ladder was an early aluminum alloy ladder manufactured by the Peter Persch Company. And it's one section inside of another section, and when it's fully telescoped, this will go out 100 feet. Now, most ladders at that time were either steel or wood, and either 75 or 85 feet. This longer length meant you could reach 2 more floors in the city's higher buildings. So it was a cherished ladder truck because it was 100 foot. The problem is, though, when you use this ladder truck at 100 feet, it's supposed to be at a vertical angle. Well, I did something wrong. Well, let me continue with the explanation. You're supposed to have it at a vertical angle if it's out 100 feet, somewhere between 45 and 75 degrees to the horizontal. Because it's very lightweight and it's not as strong as steel or some of the other wooden ladders, it should not be operated horizontally with the ground. But in order to reach these guardsmen, and if I can get my image back here without losing it, there we are. In order to rescue this guardsman, they figured out if, from the bridge approach, if you rotated this ladder around and extended it out over the cab, it would reach where they were trapped. So we got there,
And yes, they were within 100 feet. Problem was, though, they were lower than the truck. So now when you tried to go out over the cab, you couldn't go any lower than the cab. So Chief Mogul said, okay, I'm going to take one of these straight ladders that's racked on the truck, and I'm going to tie it to the end of the aerial ladder vertically. And now we're going to rotate out over the guardsman, and they can grab the ladder, and then we'll pull them out. And we all said, oh, wow, you know, that's really not the safe operating parameters of the ladder. He said, I know, but these guys are going to die if we don't get to them. They've been in the water for 5 hours. Hypothermia is setting in. We've got to get to them, and nobody, there's no other way to do it. Helicopter wasn't available at that time because of the weather conditions. So they rotated the ladder around, started to drop it down to the first guardsman. Before he could reach it, the ladder touched the water. And we're operating at a right angle to the flow of the water. It just took that ladder and bent it sideways, which made it completely inoperable because all the hydraulic cables, everything now is messed up. This is a very poor picture, but it's a copy of a picture that appeared in the Reading Eagle, and it gives you the idea of what I'm talking about. You're standing at the back of the truck. The ladder was originally going out over the front, and when the current caught it, it just took this ladder and bent it at almost about a 60-degree angle. If it hadn't been for a tree over here, the truck would have upset, because I was standing right behind Russ, and when that thing hit the water and started to go to the left, the truck lifted up off the ground this way. The operator jumped off the turntable, and fortunately, when it hit the tree, it eventually settled back down. At that point, we had to evacuate because now the water's coming up to the truck. The river hadn't crested yet. This was only like 9:30 in the evening. The river didn't crest till 4:30 the next morning. And so the truck was a total loss. It took 4 years to replace it. With all the red tape and spec writing and everything else you have to do to get a new fire truck. So I called it a day after that. The following day, the city was under a moratorium. Families should not use more than half a gallon of water a day. Well, I don't know how you do that. I had a young family of four children. Fortunately, my sister-in-law lived up in Alsace Manor. She had her own well and her own septic system, so they weren't under any restrictions. So we went up there, took showers, did some wash, came back home, and settled in for the evening that Friday. And I decided to go out again, see what was going on, because things were starting to get better now. This was Friday. So I teamed up with Al Battistini. And we went around the city, and yes, everything was going. Most of the streets were open now, the main streets. Everything was starting to recede. In fact, by Saturday morning, the river was back in its banks. However, around 11 o'clock, when I was about ready to pack it in for the day, we got dispatched to the Luden's Candy Company. Now, that's not there anymore either, but I'm sure we all remember it. And we were dispatched there for a man trapped in a sugar bin. Now, just when you think you've seen everything, you get a call like this. Well, it ended up being very unusual. What had happened was, what Luden's does, on the top floor, or above the top floor, in an enclosure, they have a sugar hopper that holds about 2 tons of sugar. And on the top floor, they have a pipe that comes through the ceiling with a tapping system on it. When they want to make a batch of candy or cough drops, they roll a big vat over underneath this area where you can tap the sugar, and it sits on a scale. There's a scale built into the floor, and they simply tap off the number of pounds of sugar they need for the formula for whatever they're making. Well, because of the extreme moisture, the sugar in the bin had caked, and so the night shift coming on found that they couldn't tap any sugar. It was clogged. Now, apparently this happened before, because up where the sugar hopper was, they had a big long pole. And they would open the top of the sugar hopper, and with a pole, they would try to ram it down in to open up the clog. Well, apparently it didn't work, so this employee, a 25-year-old employee, went up, tried it, wouldn't free it, so he put booties on his feet, and he climbed into the sugar bin. Now, there was a ladder built on the side of the wall because employees had to get in every now and then to service it, and he climbed down and stood on the sugar. And as he rammed the pole down, the sugar finally gave way, and he went right down through the center of it. Sugar came back over top of it. So now his foot is hanging out of the area where you tap the sugar. One of the ambulance people checked for a pulse, couldn't find any, but said, well, maybe circulation's cut off, so we won't pick up a pulse. Got to treat it at this point as a rescue. Maybe there's a void area where there's some air that he can breathe. So now we engaged in what fire department calls a confined space rescue operation. You're in a very close quarters. Only two people could get in the bin. And the problem was we had to remove the sugar because you can't shovel sugar like dirt. It's granulated. And when you pick it up and you throw it on a pile, it just rolls right back where it came from. So the sugar had to be hauled out by the bucketfuls, and you had to be very careful digging down to him because you don't want to jam a shovel in the guy's head, even though he may be deceased. Well, it took us 2 hours. And of course, when we uncovered his head, he was deceased. But we still had to keep going because we had to get him out of there. And they hooked up a rope with a lock and tackle, and we pulled him up around 1:30 in the morning. And he was taken to Community General Hospital where he was pronounced. So that was a very, very unusual situation, to say the least. After all this, everything else kind of settled into the cleanup, which is a labor-intensive task. These are people whose houses were flooded in the 300 block of Carpenter Street. Carpenter Street's a half street between 3rd and 4th, and 300 blocks between Spruce and Pine, if you know the city. And this is the stuff that was put out. Unfortunately, as the weather cleared, the sun came out and it got nice and hot, the stench that settled over South Reading was unbearable because all of the muck that was left that had fuel oil in it, gasoline, solvents, rotting food, and in this case, all of the stuff that was put out, molding and mildewing. It was really a long July. How this woman could sit on her porch in the 400 block South 4th Street and bear that's beyond me, but I guess when you're in it long enough, you get used to it. Now the water system, which had been out, came on very quickly. At that time, it was not the Reading Water Authority. It was actually a department of city government under a councilman. And those people worked round the clock to get the pumping station back online. It came back online. The pumps came back online on the 26th. And by June 30th, all the reservoirs had been filled. All the reservoirs are underground or in tanks, so rainfall doesn't replenish those reservoirs. It has to be pumped. And those reservoirs are full of purified drinking water. This is the Reading Sewage Pumping Station. This is the pit where all the sewage goes before it gets pumped. It had to be pumped out because the river had left all kinds of debris, dirt, mud, everything. This is something, if you're a fireman, that you don't often see in the city of Reading. And that's a fire truck drafting water. Out in the county and the suburbs, this is done quite a bit because they don't have fire hydrants. We have fire hydrants every 250 feet in the city. So we always brag that we're connected to Lake Onalani every half block. But they have to draft, and drafting's a special operation because you use the pump on the fire truck with a very hard hose line called a hard suction that won't collapse, and you use the pump to create a vacuum. And when you create a vacuum in this line, atmospheric pressure pushes the water up into the truck, and then you can discharge it from the other side of the pump. So what they're doing is drafting the water out of this pit and pumping it down to the river, which is down here at the tree line. Now the guy in this picture is sitting right back there. That's Bill Shunk. Wave your hand. That's him. 50 years ago. Anyway, as they pumped it out, of course, fish had gotten trapped that got washed in there. And I just said to him tonight, I hope you guys didn't take that back and cook it. He said no. The sewage plant took much longer. The interior, where all the controls were to control the pumps, had been underwater. The city had to place an emergency order with General Electric Corporation in Fort Wayne, Indiana, to get the parts to restore the electrical systems that controlled the pumping. So the city was then dumping raw sewage every day into the Schuylkill River. Now, the epilogue to all of this is that in 1974, 2 years after Agnes, work started on Blue Marsh Dam and Blue Marsh Lake. It had only been on the drawing board for 20 years, but now it was getting done. And this was going to solve the problem of flooding in Reading. Well, in 2006, George mentioned it, Reading flooded again. And here's the Oakham Library, and you can see the water is halfway up to the ceiling of the area where you came in tonight. And again, the whole riverfront is flooded. When you look down from the Penn Street Bridge, down the street that runs out front, this is what it looked like. So, with climate change and all the things we hear about weather, it begs the question, will there be another Agnes? Stay tuned. Okay, we're not in danger of being locked in.
Yeah, we're in the
trees. Oh, yeah. A big important part of the story, and boy, I left it out. We were all desperate after that, and we figured, you know, there's no way we're going to save these guys. And then along came the hero of Dauberville, a guy by the name of Leroy Wiest, pulled up with his high-powered speedboat. Now, Mr. Wiest, I think the Eagle said, was one of the owners of the Leesport auction. Now, I'm not sure why a guy in Leesport has a high-powered speedboat, but he's obviously very good at it. And he said, I'll get them. And we just looked at him like, boy, you're crazy. Well, he launched his boat downstream. It sounded like an airplane coming upriver. And he was coming up. Now remember, these guys are on what had been the river bank where the trees were. They weren't out in the middle. But that was better because the current wasn't quite as bad and the trees were kind of breaking it up. But you could hear him coming, and then he'd bang into a tree. And then he'd come again, he'd bang into a tree. Finally, he got to the first guardsman, got him in the boat, and his motor conked out. So now he's banging trees going back down with the current. Got it started again. And he turned around, came back up, and got the other guardsman. He was truly the hero of Dauberville. Yeah. Geez, I'm sorry I forgot that. I don't know how I did. Anybody have any questions before I invite people to come up and share their experiences. Somebody said, well, why didn't you get a helicopter to rescue those guardsmen? Well, first of all, this is 1972. The helicopters aren't like some of the ones today. No high-powered floodlights, and this was June's. So these guys were in amongst trees. You wouldn't have seen them from the air. But flying conditions were still not good. This was a misty, foggy night. It was drizzling, and there was no way to light up the area. When we started using medevac helicopters in the 1970s, every time one landed here in Reading, we had to go and mark the four corners of the landing zone and light up the zone with floodlights. Well, you couldn't do this up where these guys were. So a helicopter was out of the question. Okay, I know I have one fellow here that wants to tell you his story. So Bob? Bob Jordan, by the way, is the treasurer of the Reading Firefighters Museum. He's retired from UASA, Exide, whatever they called it.
Thank you, Chief Rehr. I have a lot of memories from Hurricane Agnes. I lived in the 200 block of South 3rd Street at the time. And a few days before Hurricane Agnes, I had just graduated from Reading High School as a 17-year-old. And I was all set to attend Penn State in the fall. But after Hurricane Agnes, those plans changed dramatically. I remember I had $2,200 saved for college at the time, which was a lot of money at the time. And I ended up giving most of that money to my parents, who lost quite a bit and did not have flood insurance. Not too many people had flood insurance at the time. But I was talking to Chief Ferrer about some experiences that I had. The first experience was my mother and father had my sister about 10 years prior. And my father told me the story that they didn't think my mother could become pregnant. Well, in 54, she became pregnant with me, and my father wanted a boy. And at the time, I guess you didn't know if it was a boy or a girl. But when I was born, he started to collect baseball cards for me. And it took me 10 years to talk about this. I just couldn't talk about it. But from 1954 to 72, I'd say my father had probably 99% of the baseball cards that were printed back then. So that morning, on the 22nd, ironically, I was working for the city of Reading in the rec department, working for Robert Duddy. And I was in the basement of City Hall. And he came down and said, Bob, do you still live on South 3rd Street? Because he knew my sister. I said, yes, Mr. Duddy. He said, well, I'm going to let you go for the day because things are getting pretty bad. We want to make sure you can get home. Well, my father was already home, and he was taking things from the basement to the first floor, including his precious baseball card collection. Well, needless to say, 24, 36 hours later, we had at least 6-7 feet of water on our first floor. So all those cards were destroyed. And if I would have known then what I knew now, I would have grabbed them, washed them off, and hung them on a clothesline in the backyard because it did heat up, as Chief Rehr said, the next couple days. But I only saw my father cry twice, and one was when his mother died, and the other was when he was drilling holes in the first floor so that he could bring the garden hose in the back door and wash everything down that he had built. He was a carpenter by trade. The other story I have is the night before, when the water was rising, I was very friendly with the fire department. I was a photographer. I took many pictures for the fire department at the time. But the command post that Charles Swifty Schaefer had was at Carpenter and Chestnut. There's a flagpole there next to Southwest. And I said to Swifty, you know, we were evacuated for sewer gas. My mother and father don't have any clothes. Do you mind if I try to get down there and get some clothes for them? Well, he said, yeah, you know, if you think you can make it. And there was another firefighter that was about 6'3", and he said, well, I'll go down with him, and we'll try to make it down to the 200 block of South 3rd Street. We lived right across from the Russian church. Well, as we got to the other side of Southwest, we crossed, there's a fence on the southern side of Southwest. The water started to push me away. And I said, Mitch, I can't get down there. So he said, get on my shoulders. And I'll bet we went, I'll bet about 50 yards down the west side of South 3rd Street, holding on the railings and anything we could to make it into the house. And I eventually did get some clothing. And Swifty Schaefer had the foresight then to have a boat come down 3rd Street. And by the time I got outside, there was a boat tied off to the railing, and we made it back up 3rd Street. But George, you'd appreciate this. I said I was active in photography. And for two summers while working for the city, I saved and saved and saved for a camera, because that was my goal in life, to be a photographer. And there was a fellow in North 5th Street, I think it was George Fisher, that took a liking towards me. And he had a used Hasselblad camera. And he gave it to me at an outrageously good price. And that camera was on the first floor. And I bought it in May and lost it in June. And never got to quite use it, but I took it to George then, and he said, I'm sorry, you know, this camera's too far gone. So those are a couple experiences, and you know, I appreciate Chief Rehr allowing me to share that with you, so thank you very much.
Anyone else?
My name is Joe Bilski, and back when Agnes struck, I was a 25-year-old volunteer with the Liberty Fire Company down at 5th and Laurel Streets, which is now the history for firefighters for Reading and Berks. Well, I was working that day, as most people would be doing, and about lunchtime, our company decided that we were going to send the employees home because of what was happening. So I went. I had been hearing about the flooding and rescues with the fire companies, so I went down to the Liberties, and sure enough, they were out on a call doing a rescue, so I waited there for them to come back. And the next couple of hours, I spent doing rescues, and we had a boat, which we were going out and using the boat to rescue people. Well, one of the things that I didn't think about, and several of the other firefighters didn't think about, we were geared up with our coats, we had our boots on, which were to across almost to your thigh bone, and we were doing a rescue on Canal Street where the water was up to the second floor. And we were going towards the window, and there was a man at the window, and we were telling him that we're going to come and get you. Well, he panicked and jumped out into the water and started swimming towards our boat. So we're trying to tell him that he has to get to the back of the boat and we can get him in. Well, he's in a panic, and he decides to go to the side of the boat, hang onto it, and lift himself onto the boat. Sure enough, he tipped us into the water. And like I said, having the boots, it was like having cement on your feet. We went down, kicked the boots off, went back up, got the boat, and we were able to get to land again, but we lost our boots. Later, in August of that year, a fella came to the fire company with one of our boots, which was my boot. They had found it in a tree near Birdsboro. No. That was one of my experiences. Later that evening, we had just gotten back from another rescue. We jumped off the truck and the truck was backing into the station house, and I'm inside the station house, and we got another dispatch. So it came over the radio, and we're standing there listening to where we're going to go next. They give the address, 606 South 7th Street. An elderly man and woman are in the house, can't get out. Well, that was my parents. And it's like, it just shocked me so much. I stood there, everybody else ran back on the truck. Truck starts pulling away out of the bay. They realize I'm still standing there. And he started yelling at me, Joe, come on, let's go. And what's the matter? And I said, I couldn't even talk. Jumped onto the truck, went down to my parents' house. Fortunately, I was able to get them out the back door where the water wasn't as bad as opposed to the front. So those were two of my experiences during Agnes. It was a rough 2 days for sure.
Shearer, a trustee at the Berks History Center. I probably don't need this, my voice carries. I have a different twist to my story than Joe's. I was on my way to Florida, unknowing that I was going to meet Agnes on the way. As we got into the Florida area, people were ditching their cars, jumping into trenches, and we decided to just carry one. So on the return trip is when we met up with the most problems. I lived in Gibraltar at the time, between 724 and the Scuba River. And I had somebody watching our dog, a neighbor watching the dog. The dog ended up in the attic. The basement up to the living room was completely flooded. And all the way back from our vacation near West Palm Beach, we went through all the ravaged areas where there were restricted travel, road, you couldn't get through the roads, we went through Virginia. We got into the Reading area, we had to get permission to go back into the house. So that's my story, a little bit of a different direction. Thank you all for coming. It's been delightful.
Anyone else? Okay, hold it. Former Fire Chief Richard Boyer.
Long time ago, 26 years to be exact. My name is Dick Boyer. At the time, I was a young fireman, started out as a volunteer at 60, by this time, 72, I was career firefighter assigned to Rescue 1. That was what we called the covered wagon. It was a heavy rescue truck. And there are several stories, one which I thought was interesting. We were assigned to go down to, and correct me if I'm wrong, Bill, I believe it was Canal Street. And this was early in the afternoon, I think right before the city declared the emergency. And they wanted us to help people along Canal Street, because the water was rising, to move their furniture from the first floor to the second floor. And we did that. However, we were sent back the next day, and it didn't matter, because the flood was at the bottom of the floor of the third floor of the attic. So all the work we had done. At the same time, when we were assigned there, there was an elderly gentleman, older than me, and he refused to evacuate. And I remember they brought the priest down to try to convince him, and I don't know if anyone was from that neighborhood, and they eventually brought the police in. And I have to assume he was persuaded to move. Another thing that comes to mind, I was coming on duty, even though I had volunteered like Bill did in the daytime. I was coming on duty on the night shift about 6 o'clock. And it was the first time, and again, correct me if I'm wrong, this is from my memory, that the city kept on an extra platoon. So for the first time in history, on the evening of June 22nd, we had a double shift in the Reading Fire Department. And obviously, it was needed. I, along with Bill, but I was on driving the rescue truck, we went out to Dauberville. And I can't tell you if the equipment we had on the truck was, well, I know it wasn't successful. We had a rope line gun. And do you want to fill that story in? Well, I wasn't there. I just gave the chief the gun.
The life gun he's talking about is on display down at the Reading Area Firefighters Museum. It's a pre-Civil War rifle, retrofitted to shoot a lifeline. And what they wanted to do was shoot a lifeline to the guardsmen. They were holding onto the tree. But then the guardsmen would have had to pull a heavy rope from the shore, because the lifeline wouldn't have been heavy enough by itself. Would have had to pull that over to the tree. He couldn't hold onto the tree and do that. So that rescue operation failed.
So it was really once, twice, thrice. And thrice did the trick with the rescue boat. Many thoughts and experiences, but those were just a few that I remember in detail. Thank you.
By the way, Mr. Wiest's speedboat was damaged beyond repair from the rescue attempt. And I don't know if anybody or an insurance took care of that. I certainly hope, if nobody, the federal government and the National Guard certainly should have. But the boat was damaged. It, fortunately, it didn't sink while he had the guardsman in it, but it was damaged beyond repair as far as further usage.
Thank you. My name's Bob Pauling. I was a teacher at Governor Mifflin in 1972. I was going to grad school at Penn State, so my first encounter with Hurricane Agnes was the inability to get to college because 322 was closed, and then when they finally opened it, there was debris hanging in the trees up, you know, two stories high, because you could see where the flood had been along the Susquehanna and also the Juniata. But the thing that took place for me that was most remarkable was that I needed something for my master's thesis, as I was a geography grad student at Penn State, and Hurricane Agnes became my master's thesis. So the effects of Hurricane Agnes on the city of Reading, I did a lot of research. I didn't have to do much checking to see if anybody had written on this before, because all the information was brand new, and by doing research I was able to find out a lot of things about the city in general. The total amount of damage, as estimated by Gilbert Associates, was about $30 million, they estimated, for the city. I did a map in here with the different circle graphs on a map to show the amount of damage, and of course, glib and paint, they suffered about $5.5 million worth of damage in that, by far the most. And of course, I guess if you want to say one thing about the flood is that it did bring impetus to a lot of change in the city. It increased some of the urban renewal areas like the 6th Ward, and also, yeah, as you can see down on the floodplain itself, the industrial renewal area in addition to residential areas. One thing I did also was a regression of the cresting of the river throughout time. I had about 80 on there, and by using the formula recurrence interval equals the number of floods plus one, and then divide that by the rank of that particular flood, and you can figure out what the interval is. So it's not the 100-year flood. This flood in 1972 is estimated to be over the 200-year flood, somewhere around maybe 230 years, something like that. So when you talk about an interval like that, the 100-year flood simply means that there's a 1% chance every year of that flood occurring. So Agnes was by far even greater than that, the greatest flood our city ever experienced.
My name is Kate, well, it was Kate Byler at the time of Agnes. I was 14 years old. So I'm the first one I've heard speaking about this from a kid's point of view. We had fun. My sister and I had a lot of fun during Agnes. We were out in the pouring rain listening to the radio, listening to the Pottstown radio station. And my first real serious experience when I thought, wow, was when we tried to get to Birdsboro. My father owned a car wash along 724 just east of Birdsboro. And to get there, we needed to cut 422 west onto Monocacy Road, which at that time had no traffic light, no left turn lane. You pretty much had to pull up, check your mirrors, and pray. So the day after, this would have been, it was on the 23rd, it was my dad's birthday, we made it across on the Monocacy Road, started down the little hill. He hit the brakes because there was a rowboat coming at us up the road. The line on the road just disappeared and these people were waving to us. So, but that, when I saw that, I thought, whoa, it took us two more days to be able to get into Birdsboro where our car wash was. And we tried coming over through Pottstown, going Route 100 south. And anyone who knows that really high railroad bridge down there, it's, I don't know how many hundred feet it is above, but the river was up to within 2 feet of the bottom of that bridge. And if you look down onto High Street, King Street in Pottstown, there was a hotel called Downtown Motor Inn on the corner of High Street and Manitonia, I believe. All you could see of that was the sign that was, it was a sculpted sign of some kind up on top. All you could see was the sign that said Downtown Motor Inn, like floating on the water. You couldn't see any part of the buildings, the ball fields, everything was just gone. And like I said, as a 14-year-old kid at the time, I had been having fun with this. And in the end, my parents told my sister and myself, pray that you don't ever see anything, pray that you don't ever see anything like this again, because this is hopefully a once in a lifetime. That's my story.
Thank you, Chief. Most of what you heard tonight is about the city. My perspective was from out in the suburbs. I live in Lincoln Park over in Spring Township. And most of what we had, and the Chief explained this too, that a lot of the reasons things were so bad was the fact that you had water that was overwhelming the storm system, and what was happening is it was going and it was going into the sanitary storm system, which is what we ended up having problems with where I was. We had people that had maybe 2-3 feet of water in their basements, but it wasn't fresh water, it was sewage water. And we actually had at points where we had to, we actually took a truck, again, as the Chief mentioned before, we actually took a truck and pumped out of the sanitary storm system. The actual, actually had a pump right out of that. And I can also say that about 5 years after that, that truck had to be completely rebuilt, because that acid of the, all that of all that water just completely destroyed that truck. But again, you can just hope that this never happens again. Thank you.
Hello. At the time, my wife and I were living on 9th Street, and my friend, which you probably know, Sailor Weaver Pharmacies, right down here at 4th and Spruce. I was a friend of Ted Sailor, and he calls me up, and he says, can you get down here? We have to empty out the basement. And I raced down there. The water is coming up Spruce Street and almost going in to the garage door, into the cellar door. So I get downstairs and Mr. Sailor says, come here. So I go over, he said, we gotta put this basket full in the toilet. He didn't let the water come out of the toilet. And, you know, I'd never seen this before. So, I put it in the toilet, he takes a 2x4 and puts it up in the room. And no water came out of that toilet. And we got the stuff out of the basement, and he really didn't get as flooded as most people. So we were lucky. And I believe it was because of that basket.
Thank you. Hi, my name's Brian Engelhardt. This is mostly about my dad, who passed away 2 years ago. The family business was a small business. Sealy Mattress was at 2nd and Chestnut. You see the Aritzky building there. It was a mirror image of the Aritzky factory. And of course, it was 30 some feet of water. My father was trying to make his way to the bank to get payroll to when there was still water in the street, and he shouldn't have been there. My mother had said on the phone, get the hell home. And I'm glad you explained this, Bill, because I always wondered until now how the hell my father fell into a manhole. He went below, and thank goodness he was able to grab, and he would have had a earlier demise than just 2 years ago. And two things about the business. It was a small business. It was a family business. There was no flood insurance. It was about 40 employees. And I never realized people cleaned up for 2 months. They did not produce any mattresses. They had to buy mattresses from other mattress companies to sell to their customers so they wouldn't lose their customers. That's life. It's business. My father was so proud of that. He didn't tell me for years, but he was. And so nobody missed a paycheck, no matter what they were. They got their pay. They cleaned up. And the other thing was, I got off a plane in New York City, I think the 29th of June. And I said, where's Dad? It was my sister and my friend to pick me up. They said, well, there's been a thing that's happened in Reading, flood. And I said, oh. So I got home. My dad said, you're gonna work my job. It was a mattress factory. Mattresses are built on springs. Springs are transported in crates in railroad cars. A crate of mattresses is about 25 mattress springs squashed together, and they weigh about a ton apiece. A railroad car full of 400 crates was delivered to Hodge's Bedding the week before Agnes. So there was 400 brand new crates in the basement there. And Mr. Europe was the ideal person to dip the mattress springs in phosphoric acid. In order to resell the mattress springs, the federal regulations, I don't know whether they anticipated, you had to dip them into phosphoric acid, and then you let them dry out, and then you sprayed them silver with silver paint. And that was my job and one other person, because nobody worked more than a week with me, and they always quit. It was not air conditioned in there, and you had to wear rubber gloves and a gas mask and a rubber apron. And I went through 5 pairs of work boots because the phosphoric acid ate my shoes away. Anyhow, so I paid for my year at the University of Vienna very well. And, but I was always proud of my dad. And so there.
Anyone else? Oh, okay.
Hi, everybody. My name's Ray Hefner, and I always remember the weirdest thing. Two weeks before this happened, I started working for the city of Reading in the treasurer's office. And I don't remember if this story, if I saw pictures in the paper, I don't think I saw it myself. Maybe I saw it on TV. But one of the businesses that was really impacted by this event was Berks Packing. And there were literally cans floating up and down Second Street. And I remember people were swimming up and down Second Street plucking those cans. And I'm sure they lived very healthy and
I was tempted.
Go ahead.
My name's Tim Waldman. As you can imagine, I'm not as old as some of the guys here that were actually lived through Agnes, but I was 8 years old. I was a kid. And we were supposed to go on vacation. And that was our thing. The family went to Brigantine, New Jersey every summer. Seagull Motel, I still remember it to this day. But Agnes happened, and our roof leaked. I lived in Spruce Street, 1100 block of Spruce Street. That's where I grew up. And I remember being upset because Agnes not only affected Reading and Berks County, it affected the Shore Points as well. And we got a call from the hotel basically saying, hey, don't come here for a couple days. We actually did make it. It was like the beginning, I lost like 3 or 4 days of vacation. But when we came back, I remember that my playground was Muhlenberg Street from like 11th Street to 15th Street, and the Rose Valley Canal from Pandora Park and Eggleman's, and that I guess ran down through there. But I remember when we came back from vacation, 11th and Muhlenberg Street had collapsed, and I think 14th, the intersection of 14th down from Cotton Street.
1400 block.
It was made out of bricks. And I remember being a kid, we used to be able to go and hear, you know, and one of the dares I remember was always that, you know, one of us, one day we were gonna walk through there from Pandora Park, but nobody ever had, you know, the guts to do that. So fast forward to 2006, I started working for the city of Reading in May of 2006, 1 month before June flood. And being in the electrical business, I was a brand new electrical inspector. I really didn't have the contacts that I knew about. But MedEd actually was proactive during the 2006 storms because they learned their lesson. And they turned off the power ahead of time to all of those places that were gonna get flooded. So basically when it came time to turn it all back on again after the water went down and they pumped everything out, they didn't have to replace everything. And a lot of the businesses there, I remember I was very busy at that point. Just actually living through that storm, you know, I was a new city employee and I was with the fire marshal and the fire department, and we were going house to house just trying to assess the damage and stuff like that. But when you saw all those barrels on the street, and this is the one thing that I found interesting, where do you think it all went when the city collected all that stuff? They took it to Fritz's Island and dumped it there. So when I was working for the city and the city was building a new sewer plant that they were now, I spent a lot of time there, but in the field where they had to build new structures, as they were digging that out, they ran into all that stuff and had to haul it away again the second time. So that was the remnants, all the remnants of Agnes went to Fritz's Island, and then from there it went, I don't know where they ended up getting rid of it, but that was a big expense for the new sewer plant because it took a month to clean all of that stuff up to get it all out of there. So that's my memories.
By the way, if you remember that picture I showed you of what the stadium looked like the day of the flood, the stadium incurred $100,000 worth of damage, and the Reading Phils lost $40,000 worth of equipment. And for about 10 days, they couldn't turn the field lights on because every time they did, the breakers tripped. So those are some of the lasting effects of that. Anybody else?
Oh,
Don't have to rush, it's not 10 o'clock yet.
My name is Mike, and June 22nd of 1972, I was 11 years old, and I actually grew up that day. I was living with my grandparents in Green Hills, and where we lived, it was an old ranch house that had been divided into two parts. My aunt and uncle lived on one side, my grandparents and I lived on the other side. In the back of the yard was about a 6 to 8 foot bank that went up to Route 10. In the front of the house was this really nice little creek that was about 4 or 5 foot wide and maybe a foot deep. I used to walk in it, swim in it, just sit there on nice summer days. Well, what happens basically is it starts to rain, and I'm thinking, well, I'm not going out, I'll just sit here and watch some TV. And I look over at my grandfather, who was the smartest man I've ever known in my life. And he's just standing there looking out the window at the kitchen. The kitchen looks directly at the creek. So time keeps going by, he's still standing there. And this man, who, if he didn't know the answer to something, was gonna find out. I mean, he was gonna type, he was gonna send it to his senator, he's gonna send it to his president, he's gonna, whatever it took, he was going to do it. So I'm sitting there and he's watching it, and I walk past and I look, and the water's now about halfway from the creek up to the house. But it's no big deal, because my grandfather's gonna figure out what to do. So a little more, time goes by, all of a sudden now the water is just about at the house. And now my grandfather puts towels underneath the door because he knows this is gonna stop the water from coming in. So, okay, I'm gonna go back and watch more TV. All of a sudden, my grandmother walks in and she goes, what are we gonna do? He looks at her, and for the first time in my life, I heard these words. I don't know what to do. The heart sank. This 11-year-old boy who just idolized his grandfather is now thinking, this could be bad. And so I say this, I was thinking about doing this and not coming up and talking about it, but at the same time, it's like in honor of my grandparents who lost pretty much everything. And a little quick side note to this, we had an old English sheepdog who had just had 6 puppies. So the puppies are there, the water starts coming in, and my grandmother gives me this big black case and says, put the puppies in there, grab the dog, we're out of here. So of course, they open the front door and, I mean, here comes the water. So I've got six old English sheepdog puppies like this, and their mom, the water is up to her neck. But it's like, I'm trying to hold her up, and we had to climb up this 6 to 8 foot bank, like I had initially said, trying to hold all these dogs in my arms. But my God, everything had turned out okay. We got them out. But again, it was all because I just wanted to make sure that I told really my grandparents' story, because as I said, I was an 11-year-old happy-go-lucky kid, and all of a sudden, that day, I turned into somebody that I just didn't know existed. So, thank you.
Anyone else? We're still good for 45 minutes. Okay, well, thank you very much. Yes.
My father's name, I neglected to say, was Theodore Engelhart. So I just wanted to say that.
Okay. Theodore Engelhart.
I'd like to make a final word there.
Before you leave, I'd like to just make one or two final comments. First of all, as I was hearing all these great stories, a thought occurred to me. We are very blessed in the city of Reading to have the first responders that we do. Thank you, good speaker. Thank you, everyone. Keep going. We're also very blessed to have a community that really is so interested in our history and these stories. It's been great being a part of this evening. So we're very thankful you all have come out. I would like to encourage you to go visit both of our sites, the Reading Area Firefighters Museum on South Fifth Street and the Berks History Center on Center Avenue. Please come see us. Tell us you were here. We'd love to see you. Some final housekeeping notes. We still have some water. Feel free to help yourself as you're walking out. Then I don't have to carry it back home. And there's a recycling bin outside by the elevators. If you could bring your bottles with you and throw them away there, that'd be appreciated. And we thank you very, very much. Thank you.